into his house. I kneel down to pray. I ask him for forgiveness for everything I've done. Ever since that day I've been running. I know he ain't dead. But I've been nothing.
Yeah. Sister Rose. Give her a hearty amen.
Well, it's good to be here. Brenda Jackson says it's good to be here. I thank God for being here. I can mark some people. Yes. Give me some water, baby. Yes, it's good to be here tonight. We're so happy for all of you. Thanks be to God that gives us the victory. And Zach, you weren't here last Sunday, were you? You need a spanking. And you can't even run if I come and get you. Shame on you. Shame on you. Oh, God is good. He's good. Yes. Yeah. We got ready to come to church tonight, and Juana couldn't find her keys. And so, made me think of the commercial where this lady's running around the house saying, "Honey, do you know where I put my keys? I don't know if you've seen it yet or not." And he said, "Honey, is it back to where they were when you, back to the place where you put it?" He said, "No, I looked there already." And so he said, he opened the refrigerator to get him some cream out, and he found her keys sitting in the refrigerator. Well, Juana wasn't quite that bad, but I said to her, I said, "Are you getting the early stages of Alzheimer's?" "No, I'm not, Mama." Said, "Y'all, you know, I should have had some younger girls younger than y'all, because y'all are getting at doing things that I'm doing. How do I get help like that?" You don't get help like that. He got this thing behind me and gone. I don't even know he's gone. Yes. But anyway, I am thankful to God for all that he is doing. It's a good day, a good time, that God is proving himself again and again. And I can't do nothing but say thank you. I thank him for everything he has done for me. He has done the impossibilities. And I was telling Sister Sarah, she walking around talking about how about them heels. I thought them heels going to throw you again. It ain't got nothing to do with your knee. It's that old age. You can have no business wearing heels that high. You're going to break your neck right across here. And the devil going to get a kick out of it. Because you said it's done. And I don't doubt that it's done. But stay within reason. You know, used to be going back to 4-inch heels at my age. That's a has-been. You don't go there no more. You have common sense. Say, I don't wear 4-inch heels no more. You ain't nothing wrong with that. 3.5 is my limit. Yeah. Tell me, I hadn't been in them shoes. You weren't supposed to be. I told one, I said, first Sunday she walked across the front of that church and fall, they got to help me not to laugh. Oh, I like to have fun with people. As you can tell, I'm in a jolly mood. I'm going to preach to you, though. And, yeah, Zach, I'm going to get you, though. I'm going to get you. If you have any Bibles, turn with me to Jeremiah, the 23rd chapter. Father, I'm thankful tonight for your blessings, for all that you've done for us. It's a privilege to be in your house, to be counted worthy of what you've done. I thank you, God, for everything, the things that we didn't understand, the things that we didn't know why. Thank you for carrying us through. Thank you for proving yourself. Thank you, God, every day of our life something new is happening. And we thank you for it today. I pray, God, that your will be done. The anointing would be upon thy servant. And we'll give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Yes. Woe be unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, saith the Lord. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God of Israel against the pastors that feed my people. Ye have scattered my flock, driven them away, and have not visited them. Behold, I will visit upon you the evil of your doing, saith the Lord. And I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all countries whither I have driven them, and will bring them again to their folds, and they shall be fruitful and increase. And I will set up shepherds over them, which shall feed them. And they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking, saith the Lord. I want to preach to you a little while tonight. God's speaking through the prophet Jeremiah, and he's saying to Israel, I'm going to set up shepherds over you. Everybody don't have a shepherd. They may have a preacher in the pulpit, but they don't have a shepherd. A shepherd cares for the sheep. They're willing to take and do whatever they have to do that they may be good, that things may be good for them. And so when I looked at these, he said, I will set up shepherds over you to feed my people, and they shall fear no more. And he said, neither shall they be lacking. And I say what's happening in the church today, they are lacking. You know, not because God didn't give them a leader and put it in there, but because they refused to come to the table and eat what's on there. Now, there's a lot of people that ain't nothing on the table. But you can't say that here. You can't say ain't no good food here. You know, it's like in the natural. You go someplace and you get some food, say, oh, this is good food. And you enjoy yourself and you tell somebody else about it. You should go over there. It's good food. So when it comes to God, it's like, where are you at? What table are you eating from? Is the food good or is it bad? Is it junk food or what is it? So you got to stop for a minute and ask yourself, you know, if God is preparing the food for me, why am I not eating it? Because if you eat it, you're going to see results. But if you don't eat it, you won't see no results. It's important for you to take in all the good things that God spreads on the table week after week for you to eat and for you not to be strengthened. It's because you never ate it. I call it a deficiency. Anybody who does not eat a proper diet, they're going to have a lack. There's no getting around that. So what am I putting in my body that's good? But better than that, what are you spiritually absorbing when it comes forth? Are you getting everything from it? Or are you one of these finicky eaters who just kind of push things aside and say, well, you know, I don't think that's for me? What do you do? Because there's no reason for people in this church to be in this little place of lack. And I can see you lacking when there ain't nothing there, but if God gave you a pastor after his own heart to feed you, you don't have any business lacking anything. Because spiritually, if the spirit man becomes strong, you don't have to worry about the natural. Increase. While the inner man is renewed day by day, the outward man is perishing. But the inner man is being renewed. So you got to ask yourself, why am I not better? If you're still fighting with the same problem, same issue, can't get past it, honey, you didn't eat. Whatever you did with the good food, you didn't eat. I was thinking, I'm sure somebody has experienced it, that you get something that you thought was good only to spit it out because it wasn't. I went to a beautician years ago. And she said, Rose, do you want, I cooked a sweet potato pie, you want a piece? And I usually don't eat anybody's food unless I know them anyway. I'm real funny about that. So I said, well, no. I said, that's okay. She said, oh, honey, come on, just get a little piece. And I said, okay. And so I sat there for a minute with the pie. See, I know what good sweet potato pie tastes like. Because I was a sweet potato queen and got nice and fat with it. And so she was up on top of my head, and I'm thinking, when she gave me the pie, when I looked at it, I thought, it's a bad pie. Because sweet potato pie is supposed to look creamy and smooth. And I saw lumps here and lumps. I thought, this is a bad pie. So I went on. I'm in a fix now because she done gave it to me. She's looking down over my head, and I'm supposed to eat this pie. And so I started picking over it. And I got a little tiny piece I thought was smooth without a lump, and I hate lumps in pies. And so I did a little bit, and I kept picking over. She said, Rose, put that pie down, girl. I can tell right now you're going to get outside my door and throw that pie away. I thought, you must have some discernment, because I sure am. I thought, I got to get rid of this pie, because I don't eat people's pie. Because when they say I can cook a mean thing, they know they can't. I've tasted it before. But I think that's what some people do. They'll say, oh, I want the word. Whatever the word says, that's what I want. You say, okay, honey, why don't you take some? And say, well, just make it a small piece. Okay, I'll give that to you. And then, in the meantime, you're sitting back on the pew like this. And pretty soon, get rid of it. It's going to be evident that you did not digest the food that was given by the way you are. So if you're showing strength, if you're showing that I've come to a place where now, you know, things are happening different for me, I'm thinking, you've been eating the food. You've been taking it. But people that are still doing it wrong, no, you didn't eat. Because when you eat the food, you must digest it. If you don't digest it, it won't do you any good. Food just held in your mouth will not help you. Or for you to spit it out on the side of the road will not help you. I got to have a good appetite, first of all, because he that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. So if I don't even have an appetite for it, you're not going to get it. You're not going to get it. So check this out. So we go to the table, and the Lord said, here's a message. And they sit there, and their mind's wandering, and it's over here, and it's over there. You're not getting what you're supposed to have. You got to be focused on the word. What is my part in the word? What is it so I can get it? Because unless you do that, you're messed up. You're messed up. So take a moment and say, why is it that every message Sister Rose have preached, anytime something comes back around, and it don't always be the same message, but what it is, it has something in it. And if something is in that message and you didn't get better because of it, understand that. Understand it. You're still the same way. So when the message comes back around again and God speaks to you, you don't get it. You know why you don't get it? You didn't eat it. See, I can tell when people don't eat it because they don't like it. And what we don't like, we spit out. What we don't like, we get rid of it. We don't keep it because I don't want that. And it's evident that you're not doing what you're supposed to be doing when I see you doing just the opposite. I'm saying, did you hear the word? Yeah, but I didn't eat none of it. Well, I didn't think it was for me. I thought it was for this person or that person. The truth is, it is for you. And you got to stop for a minute and check it out and say, you know what? I got problems of my own making. Not because I didn't have a good diet. Not because it wasn't good food. But this is of my own making. I refuse to digest it. I don't like that. I wish Sister Rose hadn't said it that way. I wish she did this or did that. I was thinking about my friend back there sitting by beyond. What is it? Bianca. So you were in the prayer line this morning, and you said, I came for a church meeting. No, I came for Wednesday night prayer, except they were having a church meeting, and so I wasn't allowed to come. And I said, well, the reason why we don't let new people come, you would know half the stuff we're talking about, because I'm dealing with stuff that's not just today, but a number of things. And then church meeting's not good for everybody at the beginning, because you got to grow where you can eat some meat. You're still on the bottle with a pacifier. You don't think you are, but you are. So she said, I took that as the message that, why don't I just go ahead and get me a job? That means I'm supposed to work. Wow. No. But what you got to deal with, that it irritated me. You don't let me in. I came for prayer, and I'm thinking, let me help you understand this. Because that's why you're not here. I let some folks in who say, yeah, I'm ready for a meeting, and they backslid right after us. You know, so we're saying, okay, but let me continue to put a little cereal in your bottle, a little applesauce, but don't put everything in there one time. You're going to choke on it. So as a pastor, I had a lady who died. died here not long ago. And she said, well, I'm the same age as Sister Rose is, and I think I can handle some things. And I've been so and so and so and so. And she said, there's no use you talking about, because Sister Rose said you're not coming. Well, I don't see why I can't be here. Why, what's wrong with me? I know how to handle stuff. No, you don't. You ain't never heard of church stuff like this before in your life. In your life. And then when I got to really come down on somebody and give them a shake, and they said, wait till you get grown. Wait till you grow up. Wait till you got some good things going on before you expect me to just let you in and choke to death. And that's what most of them want to do. They want to choke to death. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. There's food on the table. You cannot take a baby from the hospital and sit down to the table and have some black-eyed peas and cornbread. That's not going to work. That baby will be and gagging nonstop. It can't digest it. So that's why we put it on milk. And then as it gets a little bit older, we add a little cereal to the milk because he don't sleep all night. He's hollering. So I put enough cereal in his milk so he don't wake up acting stupid and stay asleep. And then a little bit time more, I put put some applesauce over in there. It's strained. It's not the junior applesauce because it has lumps in it, but this is strained, so you can eat it. Then when they keep on growing, then after a while you put a little meat in there. I used to have a whole meal in my baby's bottle. Because I'm not getting up all night. So if I stuff you before bedtime, you ain't gonna wake up. But you can't put a whole lot in there. You got to know how much to put in there because everything is strained. Everything is mush. So you don't have to worry about them choking on. Then I cut a big enough hole in the nipple so they can get the heavy stuff out. I had a lot of babies, and I could tell you something. So understand this. This was about I had to say you can't handle it. Paul said, I would feed you meat, except you're not ready to bear it. You think that you are. People get saved, and they think when they cut a few shouts or whatever, that, hey, I'm a big Christian now, a strong Christian. No, you're not yet. Hang on. Because everybody that eats, that drinks milk cannot take food. That's why we give you milk. But these people I'm talking to tonight, these are people that can swallow some food, but they refuse to swallow it. They sit up and make excuses about why things are the way they are. And I'm thinking, I don't know why I didn't do that. I don't know why this didn't happen. I don't know why that didn't happen. What did you do? Did you take what was given to you? Did you eat it? Did you digest it? It makes you strong. So you can handle some things. That the first little thing come along don't send you running off a hill somewhere because I ate good today. I got some strength. That's important. It's important. So he said, I'm going to give you pastors who will feed you a healthy diet. Good, solid food. Solid food that's going to stick with you. That's important. So check this out. If I eat right and take it in the way I should every time. Because, see, sometimes you go to the table and you say, well, I'm going to have breakfast, I'm going to have lunch or dinner, whatever. But if you don't get three, and I call it three meals to be healthy. I call it that, okay? So if you don't take that, you're going to be lacking. There is a disease that used to get children that they call it the Rickies. And that's when a baby or somebody haven't had a good, healthy diet and they start shaking like this a lot. But if you put the right thing in them, they can stand the test. They won't get upset over everything. They'll be able to go through it. They'll be able to handle it. So some of y'all can't handle anything. My son said to me, I hope somebody said to me, I'm really having a difficult time. He goes, please, give me a break. You ain't having no difficult time. The little things is throwing you for a loop. Stop for a minute. Why is everything taking my victory? Why don't I take what I've been told and do it? Because then I begin to develop into this Christian that's got some longevity. You won't have that without it. So the deficiency is a disease. And so what it does affects the church because they lack essential dietary elements, especially a vitamin or a mineral. They need that to be whole, to be healthy. So I told Nisa the other day, she said, Mom, I need to get some vitamins because I just feel so run down. I need to get me some vitamins. I said, well, get 50 plus. I'm not getting 50 plus. I said, well, you're 50-something years old. Like, I told her to go get some old person's vitamins. I just 50 plus. Meaning that some of the deficiencies that we will go through with, that as younger, you don't have it. As you get older, you have less and less of what the body is going to produce. Because you know what the body's telling you? You get ready to die. I ain't getting ready to make no more. So as we age, our body just quit making stuff. So if you don't get a supplement and put it in there, you're going to have problems. Your body's not producing all these things when you were young and it's working and working. You get older, you're lacking this, you're lacking that, lacking that. Don't get enough this, don't get enough iron, don't get enough protein, don't get enough this. And all these things started being a problem. And that's exactly what happens to the church. They sit on the pew, they're not healthy. They can't even win one soul to God. That's unhealthy. That's something I didn't digest, that it would automatically make people know that for some reason, somehow, I've been with God. I say, I make Jeanette a perfect example, is that I go on my job and there for just a short period, and people are coming up to me, and I'm talking about short period, like week, 2 weeks, people coming up to me saying, can I talk to you? Can I have some time with you? Yes. I just see the way that you are. That's a light shining. The reason why they ain't seen the way you are, because there's nothing that you are. There's nothing there. And so she says, every day. And said, so one of the supervisors came up to her and said, if you need a place to pray, we can do that for you. Not because she asked, but if you need to steal away. Who asked you on your job if you need to steal away? Nobody. Because, number one, you ain't going to steal. You ain't going to steal away. You are where you are by choice. You don't have no light. You have no salt. Therefore, without salt, you have no influence. Nobody is looking at you saying, what makes you different? What is it with you? And she's not even talking to people about it. That's what I call having the power to influence people. When you don't even have to mention it, they come to you. Because if they don't come to some of y'all, oh, it ain't happening. But they have said to her more than once, well, we'll do this, and can I talk to you? I heard that you talked to her, and you know what she was going through. Can I talk to you? Can you at least, you know, explain things to me? And from, I think the first week you was there, people was coming to church, was it? 2 weeks, people sitting in church. Not one, multiple people. Why? Because what you got somehow, it got to them. And you said, I'm not going to take that shift. They want us to work from 4 in the evening to 1 in the morning. I'll be looking for something else. I'm not taking it. I told the people that. You know what they called in and said? You know what shift you want? We want to keep you. What can we offer you to keep you? That happened to you? No, Sister Rose, never happened to me. Something is different. Something is different. I said it many times. From the time I got saved, people said, what is that about you? You don't have to be, I've been saved for umpteen years. I'm talking about a new convert saved. What is that with you? I said, it's the strangest thing. When we travel to go on vacation, there was times that people just go, hi, you ladies, are y'all singers? You just look like singers. No, we're not singers. Wow. You're so different. Yeah, we are. Boy, you look so nice. Because everybody look like bums on the plane. People don't dress up no more. They don't dress up. They're just coming like hobos from I don't know where. You know, so I'm thinking, wow. And here was this homosexual standing at the door. He was one of the stewardess. And he stood at the door. And when I start coming down the walkway into the plane, two more ladies were standing there, and he was standing there and said, oh, my God, did you feel that? Now, nothing's been said. I'm just walking down to go through the door of the plane. Did you feel that? And the lady said, such a presence. I ain't said one word. It ain't for how I look. It ain't none of those things. What is that inside of you that is contagious? Because if you digest all of the word, everything given to you, it is impossible for you not to change. It's impossible. You can't help but change. So then when I sit down, come on, say, what is it about you? And one lady said, oh, I'm a minister. She said that. The other student, that's, come here. You said she was a minister. I haven't talked. I haven't said anything. But I got a good diet. I got a diet of prayer, a diet of fasting, a diet of studying the word. Prayer, you don't have to talk. You'll talk for you. That's why people are telling me where they are and what I got, and this is the way it is. I'm thinking, no, you don't have that. My prayer life is just bubbling over. No, it ain't. No, when prayer's bubbling over you, I'm telling you, you can feel it. They don't have to say a word. From the time Minnie got up in here and started hollering and stuff, I thought, oh, she been with Jesus. I don't want to have to keep getting up because some of the dead people say, every time she has to get up, she has to try. Honey, just keep on doing it. Because ain't nobody going to be tired of your testimony but the dead ones. Because, like, what is God doing for her now? Yes. People are going to always talk about you when you really get on fire. Because they're not on fire. They're going to say, you know, she just act like she got this thing. Her and God got something going on. They do. But she's eating. She's digesting the food. It's evident she's not throwing it away. It's evident she is listening. He that hath an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit said to the church. She's listening. And she's not only listening, she is doing it. See, you hear me every week. But it's a whole different story unless you do what I say. You got to do what the word tells you to do if you expect to have results. So he said, Jeremiah, tell the people I'm going to give them a pastor so they won't have no lack. Then everything, there won't be a deficiency there. They'll have everything they need. You'll always have it if you're under good leadership. People like priests and priests like people. So if I'm going to be like the pastor, if she's following Jesus, if I'm going to be like her, you have to do what she do. She prays, I got to pray. You can't tell me. I had a prayer meeting and said, Lord, you know, I thank you and everything. Ooh, excuse me. That ain't gonna work. I'm talking about having a prayer meeting. Not one day a week, every day. Can it happen two or three times? Yes. Can it happen four times? Yes. But if you eat enough food, you know what I know what this does? It's a stimulant. It stimulizes you to want more. Want more. You know, I need some more. That's why Paul said, oh, that I might know him. He said, well, I want some more of this. But he already had a lot, but it stimulated him for more. He said, oh, that I might know him in the power and the fellowship of his suffering. Oh, that I might know him. He said, I don't have enough. And yet he was one of the greatest apostles. But he never stopped wanting more. What's wrong with these people? They don't want no more. Most times they want no more because I don't want to hear that. I don't want to digest that. I don't like it. You better take it because it determines whether you make it with God or you don't make it. It determines that. Are you going to take it or are you going to leave it? That's your choice. You can hold it in your mouth if you want to and think it's going to do you some good until you swallow it, until you digest it. It won't do you no good. That's the truth. You know what people do in this church? Sometimes visitors come and the word is so straight that they say, I got to have a break. Now, don't take a break from the table. Because everything that's there, you need it. So I thought when I looked at the one, I said, Zach ain't been here all Sunday. Now, I'm going to find out why you wasn't here. I'm going to find out. See, he's just smiling at me. I'm nice to him right now. But I'll come and get him. Look, what do you want from God? You want something from God? What are you willing to do? What are you willing to do? You can have anything you want, but you got to be willing to do it. What can I say? Did I eat good today? The first thing somebody asks you if you're not feeling good, what did you eat? That's right. I expect Aaron, I expected you to automatically say, I'm going to run this by Sister Rose, but because of what you ate, you didn't die, Jessica. You said, I'm doing this because I know she ain't going to go for it. Isn't that crazy? I ain't asking you nothing. I'm going to do this. But you're not walking in the word. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. So I'm supposed to acknowledge God and ask him about it, and you just go on making a decision, crazy decision. So I got you that night on the phone. I said, boy, you just signed a ticket for hell. You should have never done that. Yes, ma'am. And still, I couldn't hear all the testimony. I didn't find out what you said crazy until I left. And I said, I'm going to pray for you that God will let you stay put. They said, tell mama he made that decision himself. I'm thinking, no, he didn't. He didn't even ask. Sister Rose, do you think this is a good idea? Or should I do this? I would have said, you never take a baby Christian and uproot it and try to plant it somewhere else, it will die. You know why? It does not have the growth or the strength to transfer it from here to here, because in the process of the transition, they die. You say, how you know that? I've been around a long time. You watch it happen. This girl who's been coming with Sarah, God's been touching that girl tremendously. He's been blessing her. Her daughter calls and say, Mom, you need to get away for a little while. I'm sending you a ticket, and I'm sending you some spending money. Come on out to California for a while. I told Sarah, bad move. Now, if she makes it back, it'll be a miracle. You know why? You just now landed here to make a move at this time. And look how the devil does it. We don't call that the devil, but it is. I said, that's the devil. She was just, whoa, my God, she was so excited and loving and all this stuff. And all of a sudden, Mama, you need to get away. Now, that looks normal. We better understand the devil takes normal things and present it to you, and it looks like not a thing is wrong with it. But I know through experience that's a bad move. Too soon. Get rooted and grounded, and it takes time for some people to root and ground. It takes time. Because you know why? They don't take what you give them. Like I told William that time when I called him, I said, William, I said, when I call you and tell you about things that are wrong, I don't expect you to say that's right, and still stay there. So when do you say that's right, I'm changing, and change? I said, it's been years here. How much more time am I supposed to give you another spoon of the same food? If you eat the same thing over and over again, don't change. You know what? You can say, I don't want that. You got to take the word when it comes, digest it, and say, I'm getting all I can get out of this. Everybody who's hungry is fed. Everybody who goes after it is fed. But you got to come to church with, what is God saying tonight? He that hath an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. Let him listen. Pay attention. Okay? So this deficiency is affecting how you function, how you think. All these things come into play from you just not taking the word of God. And because of the lack in your life, you're not functioning well. Somebody's always going to tell you, well, I bet you this is what's wrong or that's what's wrong. But when the word comes, it tells you where you're lacking. Now take this that I'm giving you tonight and digest it. Because if you do, you're gonna start feeling better. Sometimes when I haven't eaten and the kids say, I said, well, I don't feel good. Have you ate? No, I'm not eating right now. If you get something to eat, Mama, you'll feel better. I said, I know, but I'm not getting nothing right now. Way later, maybe 7 o'clock, I'll fix something. And for that moment, it's like, whew. But you can't live there. The bottom line is, it's going to take more than daily food for you to be strong. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So you can't live just by the natural bread. Sometimes it ain't even that. They said, now, Mom, didn't you feel better? No, I didn't. It's not about that. It's about what else I'm longing for from God. God, I'm pulling on it and pulling on it. I expect to feel tired. I expect in the ministry that there are times that physically it's taking its toll on you, along with getting older. So the two things working together, and been in the ministry so long and working with people and counseling with people and listening to this issue and that issue and rebuking the devil over here and doing this and doing that. Oh, over a period of time, you're being spent. Yeah, you're going to feel it. But nothing says you're not supposed to, but it's got nothing to do with a spiritual diet. No, I got to have this. I feel like no matter how tired I am, I have to pray. I don't care how many times I prayed, I need to pray. And I look at my kids sometimes and say, there's something else I want from God. Here they go, look. Honey, if we had what you had, you don't have what I have. But is there a desire always for more? Always. More. But I can tell you now, if you expect to not end up at the end of the road going to hell, you better digest this food. It's absolutely necessary for your survival. That when the enemy come, I got the strength to fight him. That the fight I'm in does not get me down, but rather I declare that I'm more than a conqueror, not giving in to it. People that you see shifting like this, and one minute they shout, and next minute they ain't, and they up, and they down. You ain't digesting the word. What are you doing with it? Are you spitting it out, throwing it out, saving it until you get outside? Because you're not having an effect. It's not having an effect. The word always has an effect. Always has an effect. If I take it, if I tell you something, you say, okay, and you eat that, you're going to begin to feel better. Your life starts changing. You're where you are by choice. The food's on the table, but I don't come to the table. I find other reasons why I don't need to eat today. It's not good, not good. They called, when I looked in the dictionary, called something that is a deficiency, they call it scurvy. I hadn't heard that word before. A disease caused by a lack of vitamin C and characterized by spongy gums, loosening of the teeth, and a bleeding into the skin and mucous membranes. Y'all stink. You got all this stuff going on. Something's wrong with you. I mean, are you bleeding out? You smile, your gums look like who did it and what for? And you look at this thing thinking, what's wrong with you? You're unhealthy. People that are healthy look healthy. People that are not, it's evident something's wrong with them. And that's the way it is sometimes when you come to church. You look at people, boy, they look sick. They don't look healthy. You don't hear no praise. Oh, no shout. And then they always come up for prayer. What's it? Go back to the seat. Because you just need to eat. The spiritual food. Take the guidance. Take what you've been given and say, I'm going to use this to my benefit. We are here today, 50 plus years later, because we didn't stop digesting the word of God. You got to take it in. It makes you strong. It makes you up to par. But they say you can even look into a person's eyes. If you're looking at it, you'll find that when they're healthy, you can see it. If the doctor's checking, they can see in the eyes when something is wrong. And so you got to ask yourself, what's wrong with me? And I hear this. I ask the Lord, what's wrong? You ain't been eating. I tell you what you should have. I give you this, but you don't eat it. So that's why you keep going back. Honey, take this. The devil's going to get you. He's going to defeat you. And the Lord spoke to me about Tiffany. He said, college, it's not going to be about education. That's where the devil going to finish you at. He's going to finish you right there. See, the bottom line is, everything that comes in our hand, we say, God bless me. Did he? I would love for you to get an education, but I'd love for you to be saved more. Right. Saved number one. Them those men in college, they'll beat your little birdie brains out. Y'all, these young people don't even have a clue. I thought he gonna mess with you, so help me God. Get it together. Where is Kia? Oh, okay, usually over there. I said that one day, I said, do not get your head caught up with some boy telling you you're cute. The ugliest girl on the planet is cute. She's slew-footed, she's fat and bow-legged too, and they'll still say the same thing. Don't buy that stuff. Listen to what we tell you. I said, anybody ever say anything to you? No, was it one boy that said he thought she was really cute? She said that was the first semester. So in other words, is it the third year you're in? Fourth year? And so now I'm more mature than that. Did you better watch the devil? So people come by and say, watch the devil. Because least let a man take heed to himself, least when he thinks he stands, he falls. You ever say, this is where I'm going to get you at. Now I'm going to start you on a path. It's going to be a job. It's going to be this or be that. But at the end of the day, he got a plan. The devil always has a plan. That's why you better keep one. And the only one you can keep one is read the word. You got to read the word. You know what? When you're lacking and don't have enough of the vitamins and minerals and all the stuff you need in your body, you find your body shorten out. Shorten out. Oh, no, I'm feeling so good all of a sudden. One minute I'm up here, next minute I'm, what's wrong? I have these mid-morning feelings. Well, I need to get something. We always give ourselves the wrong thing. Something quick. I need some quick energy. But the quick energy won't benefit you because it's only for the moment. You need more than that. You need something that's going to last. I feel good. So, listen. You got to look at the fact that I have to have enough substance necessary to health. I have to think, what are the things I need? Fasting, praying, reading the word. Those three things is an absolute must for you to survive. If you don't do that, you can't survive. If you do one, you have a deficiency. If you do two, you have a deficiency. You have to do three not to have a deficiency. So you got to fast, pray, and read the word. Yes, you do. And when it becomes a task to you, you're not growing. Because what's a task to us, we'll only do it for a while and stop. But you got to look at yourself and say, what's wrong with me? You heard the word, but you didn't apply it. It ain't because you didn't hear it, but I didn't do nothing with it. So I just keep telling myself, you know, everything is, you know, it's okay. No, you got to know, you got to know, you got to know. Listen, some people have a defect in their mind, and the devil starts in your mind messing with your soul. Everything starts right in here. So it's a thought. A thought. You'll pray later. You haven't forgot to pray. You'll do it later. It's not doing it right now, but you're going to do it. But you tell yourself. But the day goes on. You don't pray. I'm going to read the word later. When you do read it, you don't know what you read. You can read something and close that Bible and have absolutely no idea what you read. You know why? Because you wasn't focused on that. I'm doing this because I know it's what I should do. So if I say, so what did you just read? They don't know. And when I was in school, you got a grade for how well you read, and you also got a grade for comprehensive. Did you comprehend what you read? And sometimes what you didn't in the comprehensive thing, it was a low score because you were tested on that. But now when you look at it, you didn't comprehend. You read, but you didn't comprehend. So did you read six chapters? Yes, I did. So what did you read about? I don't know, you know. I was thinking about that. I remember what I did. You're in trouble. You better remember the word. Remember it. Least we let it slip. Least we let it slip. And if it slips, you're finished. Because the devil ain't going to remind you of nothing. He's going to show you how you need to do this. And don't let the devil lie to you. Say, who was that said? Was that this morning somebody said? Well, that was you talking tonight. Well, nothing matters. Just put it in your pocket. Your pockets are gone. I mean, you can only stick so many things in a pocket. Everybody's pocket is limited to what it carries. You don't carry a grocery bag for a pocket. And in many things that you was dealing with, putting them in the pocket, that pocket ripped open, busted open, everything you put in there is gone. My son used to say, I said, so how do you deal with things when you're dealing with issues? Well, anything I don't want to deal with, I just put it in a room. Well, how many rooms you going to build before you die? You can only build so many rooms. But at the end of the day, you're going to have to go in those rooms and clean it out and deal with what you put away. It ain't going away. You got to deal with it. Where am I at in this situation? Where am I? These crazy things that people think right up here. I hear people say something. I said, you really believe that? Yeah, because I was thinking, don't. The devil's playing games with you, right? Because see, you think you're thinking, but in actuality, the devil has control of your mind, and you don't realize. You think, I'm just thinking this. No, he's got that in your mind. He's going to use it. Every sin that man will ever commit started right here. He thought, if I can't have the thoughts that are right, I know he's going to send me down the wrong road. And you know what? Life gets more and more difficult the less we deal with the things that's confronting us. Confront that, move on. Move on. Listen to what God is telling you, and don't tell me what a revelation you just got. Okay? Because the devil messed with your mind. He'll mess with your mind. That's what he did to my friend. Well, that means you should just get a job. No. But see, we know that. You don't know that. I said, oh, no, honey, that wasn't what it meant. But because you don't know as a new convert, he takes an advantage. So if you ask. You know what? People don't ask sometimes because they know what the answer is. If I ask you, I know what she's going to say. So I'm not going to ask her. And so when you fall down and bust your lip and black your eye and do all those things, then they say, Sister Ro, you tell me why, how you do. I could have saved you that. You just had to ask. You didn't even have to pay to ask. It's not like you got a counseling session that you got to come up with some money. It costs you nothing. Why, if I got paid for every time I counsel somebody that's crazy, I'd be rich. In the last 50 years, I would be rich. Think about it. But say, you need to make up in your mind and say, Lord, you know what? I'm just going to listen to what I've been told. I'm going to do that. I'm not going to question. I'm not going to have to go through any changes. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to do it. You can do it. You can become a healthy, thriving Christian once you delete all the crap that's in there. Get rid of that stuff. Start putting in good stuff. I'm going to do it right, the way God wants me to do it right. That's what I'm going to do. You can do it. I made up in my mind, whatever they told me to do, I was doing it. I just got saved. There's a lot of things I don't know. I want to know what do I do, and I'm going to do it. People don't say that. Listen to this that came from the Living Bible. I wrote it out. It says, my people build a flimsy wall, and these prophets praise them for it and cover it with whitewash. Tell these evil builders that those walls will fall. A heavy rainstorm will undermine it. Great hailstones and mighty winds will knock it down. And when the wall falls, the people will cry out, why didn't you tell us that it wasn't good enough? Preacher, why didn't you tell us we shouldn't have done it this way? Why did you let me go on believing this? And then he says, and why did you whitewash it and cover up its faults. So if you whitewash something, it's to keep the real thing from showing, and it puts a gloss over it, and that's what preachers do to people. So you never really know who you are and where you are because it's glossed over. You ain't got no gloss in here. You can rest assured ain't nothing glossed over. Says, here's what the Lord God says, I will sweep it away with a storm of indignation and with a great flood and with a storm of indignation. And I will break down your whitewash walls, and it will fall on you and crush you. And you shall know I am the Lord. The wall and its building are gone. They were lying prophets, claiming the church would know how to handle or give you peace. There is no peace, but they tell you that it's going to be whitewashed. I just gloss over it. I just put it right. I just changed the language. I thought today when I was sitting at home, I thought, God, you know why so many unsaved people say they saved? Because the church has let down a standard. So that we're all Christian, and we do everything you do. We curse, we lie, we go to the club, we drink booze, we whore around, we do all this stuff. Hey, come on over here. He said, that what they told you, you're all right. God knows how you are. He knows we're human. He understands that. And it may put you into a position where you digest lies and poison and expect to survive it. You cannot survive it. If you don't get truth, you can't survive. Without truth, it won't work. Everything that you're given, if it's not based on truth, it will not work. So if I'm going to become whole, if I'm going to be the person that God wants me to be, I am going to have to follow the word and quit looking for somebody to make you feel good about where you're at. You'll never leave where you're at if I say, you're good. You're really okay. You made some good strides. Just stay there. No. And the thing is, until we die, we got to keep on progressing. Anything that stops moving starts stinking. Anything that has no movement, it starts, all kind of fungus and stuff get in it. That's why Christians are that way today, because nothing's moving. And they just keep on believing that everything is okay because no preacher touches it with a 10-foot pole. Don't tell them that. They'll leave the church. They won't stay with you. You keep listening intently just like you're doing right now. Every time you come to church, digest this, because the devil's got a plan. I warn you more than one. Every time I kind of look at it, he got a plan. But you're listening like this. Now open your mouth and shove it down your throat and digest it in your belly. So when the devil comes along, I got enough strength, enough power that you ain't getting ready to pull me down. One, be careful. Watch the women. Watch them. You think you know women? Women are some of the most conniving, sneaky people on the planet. That's the truth. They're sneaky. I mean, women can get you to do something, make you think it was your idea. You know that's true. I'm going to make him think he wants this. Yes. Shame on me. I did it to my husband. When I really wanted him to do something, I know how to do it. That was years ago, many years ago. That was when we was a lot younger. I didn't have to do that anymore as time went on. But at the beginning, he don't want to see me. He don't want to see me upset. He's already stated that. I don't like to see you upset, honey. So I've got something I need him to okay. What do? Go in the room by yourself, sit there for a little while, get ready for the show. So Charles walks in the room and I'm like this. He says, something wrong, Pooh? I don't know, I've been thinking about some things. And he said, you want to talk about it? Honey, I don't want to bother you. Well, honey, you can talk to me. I know. Well, honey, I hope you understand. See, I'm knowing he's not going along with this unless I put on the show. He's not going to do it. So I'm doing the show now. I'm going to get what I want. So I sat there and he said, come on, Pooh, you can talk to the Pooh, honey. I said, I know, honey, I live on the show. I said, I know, I can talk to you almost about anything. He said, yeah, I'm here for the Pooh, but I know. I'm breaking him down piece by piece. Piece by piece. I know he's melted because I can feel it. I said, Poop, what is it? Come on, tell the Poop. I don't want my Poop up upset and unhappy. I said, Charles, here it is. I wanted to go down because he never liked me to make a bill ever for no reason. And I said, could you come in for me? Let me show you something. See this right here? Charles, that is so worn out. And sometimes you come in here, you sit down, it's uncomfortable and all these things. And honey, could I just at least look for a new couch? Now, I'm going to get the tables. Just a new couch. That couch has got the tables and the lamps. But I'm not bringing all that to the table because he's not going to want that. So I said, honey, I would like to get at least a couch. He said, well, honey, you can get a couch. Well, that's all I need. So when the truck pulls up, but when the truck pulls up, now the delivery people bring off the tables and the lamps, and he said, what's that, Poop? I said, Poop, they had such a good sale on that. He said, they did. I said, yeah. I said, I know you wouldn't care if it was on sale. He said, no. I said, honey, a good price. He said, what is that? I said, tell him what it is. Yeah, Poop, that ain't bad. I thought, I got it. I got the whole living room set just by going in the room. Just keep that. I wish I could. I was good enough to cry, but I don't have them kind of tears. So I just look pitiful. But I got him going. That's why I said, don't men, women will play you all day long, and you make him think it's his idea. Honey, I know you would have wanted this. That's why I went on and got it, because I thought my husband, he don't like this kind of stuff. And then he'll think a little bit. He said, well, yeah, that's true. And he don't know. I just dumped that in his head. Let me tell you something. The devil always comes here. He always got a show. Don't buy into it. He's always going to show you how this will work. And the reason why it didn't work for anybody else is how they did it. But if you do it just like this, and if you do it like that, you can get that to work. It's going to hurt you. Now, if you take the warning, and he always warns before anything happens, if you take the warning, understand, and say, I'm going to watch this. I'm not going to, if it don't happen in a week, if it don't happen in a month, it may be 6 months, it may be a year. Keep watching. The devil says, because as long as you know and you've been told I'm coming with this, I ain't coming right now. Because you're watching for me. I've got to wait till it gets a little old to you and get on down the road. And then, now here it is. You ain't going to never keep the victory until you understand the enemy. And Paul said we are not ignorant of his devices. It's a lot of folks ignorant. But we ain't supposed to be. Stop a minute. I recognize that's the devil. Most people, when the devil got them on a trip, they don't know it's the devil. He tripped them right on out the door. He knows how to do it. He's been playing this game longer than you've been living. He knows how to get people. So you praise God and shout today, and then a little something happens this week, and you come back and say, well, you know, it ain't that I don't still have joy. It ain't that. Yeah, it is. You ain't got no joy in facing. And it ain't that. I said, something bother you? No. I told the devil when he came, he's a lie. He didn't believe it. Because he got you. Listen, we've been around long enough to tell you when the devil's playing a game with you, listen to us. Listen to what the word is saying. It's nothing that you won't need. and use in this war. And if you got a leader that can see further than you see, further than you, here's what y'all see. We see all the way back to that wall and beyond and say, you don't know what you're getting into. Look at that. Look at that. So over a period of time, the enemy begins to deplete you more and more because he knows it's a matter of time before he's going to get you, and he doesn't mind taking his time to get you. The devil comes back years. I read in one of my tablets I wrote in, and I wrote this about Sam. It was February 2010, and I said the devil is slowly, slowly poisoning him. February 2010. And no matter how much I warned him, no matter how much I talked to him, no matter how I said, you better not do that, you should watch this, whatever. The devil took 6 years to finish it, but he finished it. I don't want to go to hell now or later. So look at your life and say, I don't want to go to hell regardless. I don't care how much he's willing to wait till he gets me. I don't want to go to hell. You cannot go wrong if you take the message that comes in this pulpit and say, and you can even go home and read it again and start looking at it, studying it even more. I'm going to listen to what I've been told because God has given us a leader so we won't have no lack. No lack. Think about it. So I'm never not going to do my job because this depends on whether I get to heaven or not. I couldn't walk out here and say, I ain't y'all pastor no more, see you. Oh, no. Do I feel like it? Yeah. Am I going to do it? No way. Because if I don't do my job and deliver this, I'm in trouble and I'm lost. Paul said, woe be unto me if I don't preach this gospel. I got to preach it. So tonight, think about it when you go home. Just don't go home and get your mind on something else and having something to eat and all these things. Think about what the word said tonight. Keep thinking about it. And just keep pushing it in. And then when the devil comes, he can't get you. He can't get you. See? I have never one time in this church since I've been pastor ever warned or told anybody anything that it did not happen. Never. Never. So, listen. I'm here for your good. If you see a righteous man, warn him. If he seems to be pulling away, if he seems to be going wrong, pull him in. If he don't listen to you, at least it's not on me anymore. Think about it. I know that God is saying to people in this room, you better listen. You better take this. You should be able to feed on this all week and on anything else you want to add to it. You got something to think about. I'm not supposed to have lack. I get plenty good spiritual food. I'm not supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to be shook up. I'm not supposed to be worried. No. Whatever the devil brings, and he always surprises people over a period of time, don't let him do it. It's here tonight. Take it. It's not a message for you that I can't go to college, but it sure tell you he got a plan. And the thing about it, the flesh, what he offers you, the flesh wants it. That's where the problem is. So the first time some joker walks up talking trash, If we could be there, you seen this this commercial where this woman has this bowel problem and her stomach is running around with her. That's so stupid. And I think, boy, what would it be like if everywhere y'all went, I was standing back watching, don't do that. I'd be dead though in a short time. Don't do that. You got to take this. Remember what's being said. I can't go get an education. I don't have to be messed up. But the possibility of you getting messed up is absolutely real. Don't forget it. Think about it. I'm here to help you in any way I can. God bless you. Love you. Glad you're listening tonight. This is a warning message. Digest it. Because if you didn't digest it, we know you can't grow. Do you remember me reading the thing about the digestive system? If your digestive system is messed up, your whole system is messed up. You've got to be able to take this. God bless you. Stand to your feet. Every one of those little people that went out of here, I'm already praying for you, baby. Why are you scared? I'm not going to do it. No. Hold on. If I'm afraid of it, I know where I'm at. See, because if I'm not there yet, I don't have to be afraid. But see, you know you. That's why you're scared. Because I know, but I know. That it's already been there.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so the Lord sends you a warning and say, don't do that. Because, see, you know you.
Exactly.
And already, see, he already spin these thoughts through your head even before you get there. I'm going to set you up. He has to set the scene. He's going to set it up. You know it's set. That's why it's scary. But you don't have to stay there. You have to stay there and say, no. I got to get out of here. I got to change my thoughts. Because if you don't, Mr. Q is waiting on you. Oh, yes, he's smart. He's stupid. He's a bunch of things. Listen to me. Listen. You don't have to do it. But here's the thing, though, Tiffany. You got to get out of the place where you're at.
That's right.
See, if I'm not in that place, I don't have to worry about the devil. I'm not there. But if you're there and you hear that, it's like, oh, my God. I've been thinking. He keeps up with the stuff in your head. Who don't want a good education? That's a good thing. But rest assured, the devil is there to give you a run for your money.